I think we have time for one or two more questions. Short questions and even shorter answers. There's one over here and one over there.
Thank you. Claus Ilum, Denmark. I wonder, now you're painting this all this problem complex green. In reality, it is foreseeable that by 2020, 2030, the OECD countries will have to do with much less oil, probably 50% by 2030, and less coal for climate reasons. But at least much less oil. And by 2050, what is left for us to use of fossil fuels will be practically zero. So it's not a matter of something being greasy and nice, it is a matter of necessity. And I think that is an important point, economically also, that this is not an option you have. This is something that is a fact, that by 2050, at least if not sooner, we will be out of fossil fuels. Thank you.
Now, that wasn't a question, it was a comment, so we won't go into that one. And there was a lady over here.
I think it wasn't that bad, we should answer it.
Well, perhaps just to complete the gender distribution. My name is Katarina Amitsbøl. I'm from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Denmark, working on the new government initiative on promoting global green growth. I think it was Andreas Goss who gave me the keyword. You said the policy framework is actually essential. Now, having the COPs in mind, do you think, I'll ask the panelists, do you think it's possible to create the right global governance architecture system that will create this enabling framework? And how do you think, if you're going to lift this globally, how do we educate the new consumers? I mean, if you look at from the bottom of the pyramid principle. And the last question then is, what is the role of the corporate sector in this? Thank you.
Super way to end. Short answers?
Corporate sector.
Yeah. Oh, corporate sector.
Should I take part
sure.
of it? Do I think there will be a global governance, a new global treaty? No, I don't think it will happen. It didn't happen last year here. I don't think it will happen. It's too ambitious for the world we have. I think even last year it was very stressed and probably rather optimistic to think, even if they could have agreed on such a deal, how should it be implemented? How should it be handled in such a complicated global society as we have? We have seen in the European Union, they have been living with this cap and trade system for some years. It works, but it's very complicated even within these very regulated economies. How should this work on a global scene? So, but I don't think it will be decided. If it's decided, I think it will be very difficult to handle it. So I'm not very optimistic about that. That's the reason why we have to make things happen without such an agreement.
And I guess you indirectly answered the question of what you think the corporate role is in that.
I would almost want to combine both the questions. And I mean, it was a fiery comment, but it had enough, certainly, potential for a strong question to be answered. I agree with the fact that we will not have a global policy framework. It's very unlikely in the time frame. It's very unlikely in the political mechanic of today. And I think you saw a showcase in this very room how things can derail quickly with particular interests, you know, being brought together and wanting to be amalgamated. So very quickly answering that, I think we will see regional solutions from a policy framework standpoint, and we see them as we speak. So the nations that have no access, or no is the wrong word, more limited access to fossil fuels, as you pointed out, will, of course, be forced to maybe speed up the agenda and decarbonize, use other sources, use renewables, and so on and so forth. Other nations, like China, will have, and I mean, maybe that puts a little dent in the entire discussion, but other nations like China, who bring up three, four coal plants every week, will have to make a different call, yeah, as to how much they want to chip into the race. And there, and that sounds a bit sordid, but it's true, there what Bruce said comes into play, namely the efficiency of the use of all those sources. And even there, you know, in a transition phase, things can be done which help the climate change agenda substantially. If you think that the efficiency of those plants was 37% a couple of years ago, now we're talking 66%, so two-thirds towards a perpetuum mobile and other things, you know, I mean, there are technology solutions that make the resource use at least a bit more or a bit less gloomy. So it's not a perfect picture, and we will not have a completely decarbonized economy worldwide anytime soon, but we will certainly, I think with Verve and with great determination, regionally different, go the route of preservation of resources and climate change, in my view.
I think...
One comment. One, I promise. How to do it? Just start at schools. Start to work on the children, because that's the generation of tomorrow. And if they are convinced that environmental impact is a big issue, they will also start in their job, in the way they act and so on, to work on that. And we have seen the progress already. Just start there.
Miguel?
I have to agree. I think it's down to people. It's down to us. The American philosopher and inventor, Buckminster Fuller, said that if you want to create real change, don't fight the existing. Offer an attractive alternative. And that's what we can do to make people move in that direction.
Super. I think that was a great way to end this session. I'm personally convinced that the greatest challenge that humankind is facing in the next 100 years is actually learning how to share the resources that 9 billion of us are going to have to share, and energy resources are obviously one of the important. So there'll be different ways of doing it, and we're embarking on a very exciting journey. So thank you very much for your contributions, and please give a hand to the panel. Okay.